Good morning, good afternoon, or good evening. Really doesn't matter what time of night or day. I'm still just as happy that you stopped by my channel. Thank you ever so much. If we're meeting for the first time, my name is Reverend Paul J. Bern. I'm the online pastor of the online faith-based community known as the Social Gospel Worship and Learning Center, based in Atlanta, Georgia. Sending blog posts and videos around the world. We're an online church, to put it simply. There is no brick and mortar to be found here. No denominational teaching. No man-made theology. No political ideology. What we do talk about, instead of all that, is Jesus Christ, crucified, died, and resurrected on the morning of the third day. For that magnificent morning. Seated now at his Father's right hand, just waiting for the cue from his dad that it's time to come take us home. And take us home, he will. For today, this is going to be another installment of my ongoing biblical study series, where we go through each book of the Bible, chapter by chapter, verse by verse, in the order that it is in the Bible, in the order that it is intended to be presented. This will be Acts chapter 27, verses 30 through 44. Acts chapter 27, part 3. So let's get underway here without further ado. Now, last week, as we left off at verse 29 of Acts chapter 27, the storm that was battering the ship they were traveling on had become so severe that those on board were helping the crew toss the cargo overboard in an attempt to save the ship and themselves. Had this particular vessel been equipped with a modern form of propulsion other than sails, they would have stood a fairly decent chance of being able to outrun or go around that storm. Instead, they found themselves caught up in it as they were being pushed along with it by the winds. As we begin part 3 of this week's lesson on Acts chapter 27, we find, finally, that their circumstances is showing signs of changing for the better. So to begin this study, verse by verse, let's go to Acts chapter 27, verse 30, for our first scriptural quote of the day, part 1. And it reads as follows, and I quote, "In an attempt to escape from the ship, the sailors let the lifeboat down into the sea, pretending they were going to lower some anchors from the bow. Then Paul said to the centurion and the soldiers, 'Unless these men stay with the ship, you cannot be saved.' So the soldiers cut the ropes that held the lifeboat and let it drift away. Just before dawn, Paul urged them all to eat." And quoting him here, it says, "For the last 14 days, he said, you have been in constant suspense and have gone without food. You haven't eaten anything. Now I urge you to take some food. You will need it to survive. Not one of you will lose a single hair from his head." After he said this, he took some bread gave thanks to God in front of them all. Then he broke it and began to eat. They were all encouraged and ate some food themselves. Altogether, there were 275 of us on board. When they had eaten as much as they wanted, they lightened the ship further by throwing the grain into the sea. That's verses 30 through 38. We'll stop right there before we proceed any further. Now, time for the explanations and analysis. First, without a doubt, the ship the Apostle Paul was on had just experienced a near catastrophe at sea. So much so that Paul said in verses 31 to 32, "Unless these men stay with the ship, you cannot be saved." So the soldiers cut the ropes that held the lifeboat and let it drift away, close quote. By now, it was clear that Paul had quite a bit of sailing experience, even to the point of knowing what to throw overboard and what to keep. Sometimes, life could be like that. There are times in life when we see clearly to our intended destinations, and still other times where we can barely see our hands in front of our faces. But the Bible tells us repeatedly that he or she who holds out to the very end will most certainly be saved by the blood of the Lamb. That's Matthew chapter 24 and verse 13, by the way. He who holds out to the end shall be saved. That's what Jesus said. Subtitle. Sometimes it's okay to take a break. Once again, beginning at verse 33, where I just quoted from, the Apostle Paul begins to have a greater role, not in the fate of the ship, but in the lives of those who were on board with them. Saying and doing what needed to be said or done, as he encouraged the men on board, he urged them to stop and eat something. He said, "For the last 14 days, you have been in constant suspense and have gone without food. You haven't eaten anything. So now I urge you, take some food. You need it to survive." After he said this, he took some bread and gave thanks to God in front of them all. Broke it and ate it. The continuing efforts to save that ship and all on board. Now, I don't know about yourselves, but I don't really see myself as being the type of personality that could endure 2 weeks at sea without eating anything. It's no wonder that once Paul had baked the loaf of bread he was about to consume, the rest of them joined in immediately, and I quote, "They were all encouraged." This is in verse 36 here. "They were all encouraged and ate some food themselves. Together there were 276 of us on board. When they had eaten as much as they could, they lightened the ship by throwing the remaining grain into the sea," close quote. And so, you see, even though it was evident that the storm was no longer their biggest problem, they had continued in a state of heightened alert since the ship had been damaged by the storm to the extent that it could no longer carry its cargo, let alone the 276 individuals on board. And so they continued to throw heavy objects overboard. Let's hold that thought as we continue to the second half of this week's study, beginning at verse 39 this time. Sorry about that. And I quote, beginning at verse 39, when daylight came, they did not recognize the land, but they saw a bay with a sandy beach where they decided to run the ship aground if they could. Cutting loose the anchors, they left them in the sea and at the same time untied the ropes that held the rudders. Then they hoisted the foresail to the wind and made for the beach. But the ship struck a sandbar and ran aground. The bow stuck fast and would not move, and the stern was broken to pieces by the pounding of the surf. The soldiers planned to kill the prisoners to prevent any of them from swimming away and escaping. But the centurion wanted to spare Paul's life and kept them from carrying out their plan. He ordered those who could swim to jump overboard first and get to land, the rest of us to get there on planks or some other pieces of the ship. In this way, everybody reached land safely. That's verses 39 through 44 of Acts chapter 27. For the sake of expediency, let's pause on this one for a minute. Those aboard what was left of that ship were being presented with a choice in verse 39. Those choices were to go for that beach or attempt to find a better one with a deeper harbor. Either way, the voyage was over. One thing I have learned over the years when it comes to being a servant of the Lord Almighty is to never try and second guess God. Sometimes when a solution to a problem is presented to us, we are to be ever thankful as we receive it, even if it doesn't seem right at first. This inevitably leads to our own differentiation between our emotions, our logic, and our souls, or our spirits, if you prefer. The apostles Paul and Luke, together with Aristarchus of Thessalonica, refer to the last two installments, the last two Bible studies, to find out more about Aristarchus of Thessalonica. Now, Julius, their Roman guard, and the other 260 or so passengers and crew knew that if they saw land with a suitable beach, they should make for the shoreline immediately. No speculation about a better landing spot was ever considered. They simply did what needed to be done. Necessary steps had to be taken. Life and how we live it puts us in similar predicaments today. Sometimes we are presented with a choice that doesn't seem to fit our situation at first. Oftentimes it's because we've seen better choices in our own pasts to the point that the current choice seems inadequate somehow. That's also known as FOMO, fear of missing out. That acronym. That's what the beach may have looked like just before they hit that sandbar. But first, they had to cut loose all that was holding the ship back, like the freight. Back in verse 18 from last week's study, everything that held that ship down or kept it from moving forward was thrown overboard or cut loose from the ship. Had any of these drastic steps not been taken, they would have sank before they made it to shore with the probable loss of everyone on board. A nearly miraculous ending, then, is what that is to this tale of survival. By now, Paul's strong faith in Christ combined with the prayers from the people of faith who were on board, had made a deep impression on everyone else. So taken aback with the formidable faith of Paul, Luke, and the others, with the rest of those on board, the Julius Centurion put an end to the plans of some of those who on board who wanted to one of the prisoners executed, as we saw in verses 42 and 43 that I just read. Instead, he organized a plan of escape so that, at the end of the chapter, everyone reached shore without the loss of one single life. This is a really great ending to a harrowing tale of being lost at sea for 2 weeks, only to culminate in a successful landing with no fatalities. That's why I call it a nearly miraculous ending. And this isn't just a story or anything. These things actually occurred. And there is this written record of it, parts of which I am reading back to you. So, what was in store for the apostles and the others now? First, they needed to get their bearings straight by identifying their location. But that is something I must hold in reserve until next week's biblical lesson. For the sake of brevity, we'll cut it short right here and pick up in part 1 of verse 28 next time. So until then, stay in tune with God. Continue to live your faith as a lifestyle. God willing, I will be back next week to start the final chapter of the book of Acts, of this biblical study series. Normally, at the end of a church service, or a Bible study here, a collection basket is passed around, or collection plate, if you prefer. I can't do that. I'm not brick and mortar. I'm online only. One thing you will never hear me do is ask you to please tithe 10% of your income to me. I don't do that. There are so many people nowadays that can no longer afford it to donate 10% of their income. They're already being squeezed severely. And so I make no demands for alms. But by the same token, I gotta keep this online, on the air, gotta keep it going. And I've got expenses of my own from this. Any donation that is sent here goes directly to the ministry. I take none of that money for myself. I work without a salary. I do this for free. It's a labor of love. Love for my Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. If you can afford to donate, if you'd like to send something, it would be very much appreciated. We're a registered nonprofit on PayPal. The email address for PayPal, for our organization here, is greatestservant62@gmail.com. That's all one word and all lowercase. Greatest Servant, number 62, at Gmail. You can also donate on Stripe. Go to Stripe's homepage at stripe.com and type in Social Gospel Worship and Learning Center. It'll pop right up on the screen for you. Fill in your amount and send it off. Nothing to it. Help us with our office expenses, with our expenses with keeping us on the internet. And for a lot of, or at least as much as I can, of some money for marketing and promotion. All that costs money. So that's why I'm asking for it. That's why. Don't forget to give me a like, since you listened to this all the way through. Thanks for that. A like and a share. And subscribe. The subscription is free for the YouTube channel. You can also become a member of the Social Gospel blog. Social Gospel Worship and Learning Center, our little blog. We got one of those. It's in three different places. It's on WordPress, on Medium.com, and on Substack.com. It's $5 a month, or $50 a year, which works out to about 16 cents a day. If you can help us that way, if you want to help it, can't afford to give in a larger amount, then that's a good way you can support us too. The address for that is pbern.substack.com. That's pbern.substack.com. Before we go, I'd like to take this opportunity to thank you for the privilege of your time. You are all so very, very much appreciated. And so, having said everything that I could say, everybody be blessed. Yes, I said be blessed. In Jesus' mighty name.